Morning, good to see each and every one of you. Stand with me if you will. Page number 505. Love lifted me. Page 505. We'll do all three verses.
I was sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore. Very deeply stained within, sinking to rise no more. But the master of the sea heard my despairing cry. From the waters lifted me, now safe am I. Love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me. Love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me. All my heart to Him I give, ever to Him I'll cling. In His blessed presence live, ever His praises sing. A love so mighty and so true merits my soul's best song. Faithful, loving service to Him belongs. Love lifted me, love lifted me. Oh, when nothing else could help, love lifted me. Love lifted me.
All right, hold on just a second. All right, now I haven't been doing all the lifting like everybody else, so we will this last time because these two guys in the back have been coming up out of their chairs, and so it's like it's hard to sing and keep a straight face with those guys, but we'll do it. When we get to the lifted part, let's lift up that love lifted me. Okay, I'll get them on the last part, though. Last verse here.
Souls in danger, look above. Jesus completely saves. He will lift you by His love out of the angry waves. He's a master of the sea, billows His will obey. He, your Savior, wants to be saved today. Love lifted me. Love lifted me, love lifted me, love lifted me. Oh, when nothing else could help, love lifted me.
Brother Gary, open us up in a word of prayer, please.
Amen. All right, you can be seated this morning, and I do welcome you and greet you to our morning worship service here at Parkwood Baptist Church. One preacher said during that song to his church that they were practicing for the rapture, just getting a head start. And listen, you won't need any practice for that. And the Greek word is harpazo. It means to be snatched with force, all right? And so you'll be snatched with force out of this world when that takes place. But certainly, what a wonderful truth that love, by the way, that's Jesus Christ, Amen. Lifted us. And so thank you, Brother Ken, for leading us in that this morning. Let me make a few announcements, and we'll move forward into our service. First of all, if you're a visitor, thank you for being here. And if you're a first-time visitor, there should be a connection card somewhere close to you in a seat back. Fill that out, if you don't mind, and place it in the offering plates. when we pass those momentarily. We would love a record of your visit. And if you are a first-time visitor or a second or third time, but you never got your first-time visitor gift, then come see us after the service. We've got a gift to give to you, and just our way of showing some appreciation for you being here. As far as announcements go, if you grab a bulletin, there will be a QR code inside of it. I don't know if we have a slide on that. It's for a meal train for Kevin and Cassandra. All right, I didn't think we did. Okay. All right, but it's in the bulletin, so grab that. There's a QR code. And if you can help provide a meal for Kevin and Cassandra and Ethan and baby David, then scan that QR code. It'll take you to the sign up for that, and make sure you sign up and get that meal to them for whatever date you choose. Good to see Kevin here this morning. We've been praying for you and for Cassandra, and are thrilled for you and your family. And so let's be a blessing to them, and certainly they're a blessing to us. Speaking of Kevin, he'll be preaching Wednesday night, and as you know, Brother Mark Thrift and I will be leaving Wednesday morning, headed to Slovakia. We'll fly into Vienna, Austria, and then we will get a car and head to Trencin, Slovakia, to be with our missionaries Joseph and Anna Oberman and their family and their churches, and we'll be there for about a week. A missions conference is going on, a dedication of a building that we help pay for will be taking place as well, and so we appreciate your prayers as we make that long journey. But in my absence, Brother Kevin will be preaching Wednesday, and then on Sunday, Brother Dennis Irwin will be preaching in both services next Sunday night, and so look forward to that, and be praying for Brother Dennis. I know he's looking forward to being here with each of you. I made this announcement Wednesday night. But as always, when I take a mission trip, I like to bring a love offering. And there are miscellaneous expenses that come up that the missionary has when we visit, whether it's meals or travel and gas expenses, different things like that. And so we always bring a love offering to give to the missionary. And so if you want to contribute to that, then you can do so. Now, this one will be twofold. As I mentioned, Brother Mark Thrift is coming with us. And of course, as being an evangelist, he will not get paid this week. He won't receive a love offering as this is a mission trip. And then, of course, he has expenses on top of that. And so we're going to give a portion of this offering to Brother Mark and then a portion to Brother Joseph and Miss Anna. And so if you can help out with that, just put it in the offering envelope. Make sure you notate that. You can put Slovakia. We'll know where that money needs to go. And so help us out with that if you can. If you can't, no problem. We certainly understand and appreciate your prayers. But if you can, then I know those men would be very grateful, and I would as well. Let's see. Mentioned Brother Kevin, you're in the bulletin a lot this week, brother. And preaching Wednesday, meal train, and then also there's a basket outside the nursery. That's for them as well. And as you know, they just welcomed the birth of their little boy, David Alexander Vargas, and says here he was born October 14th, which was last Monday, 7 pounds, 5 ounces, 19 and a half inches in length, and so a healthy baby. Congratulations to them. Again, let's be a blessing to this family, and you can bring a gift for them and just put it in that basket. That basket will be available for the next few Sundays. All right. I don't know of any other announcements, and I don't see any birthdays or anniversaries in the bulletin. And, there's a hand. Oh, we've got one. All right. All right. Well, happy birthday, sweetheart. This is Brother Ronnie's granddaughter, and Kurt, his family's little girl. Kurt, remind me her name. I'm sorry.
Lexi.
I knew that. Lexi, happy birthday, Lexi. How old will you be, Lexi? 8 years old. Well, that's tremendous. Happy birthday to Lexi. Is that today or this week? October 7th, so it was a couple days ago. Happy birthday, Lexi. Happy late birthday to you. Happy 8th birthday. Well, let's sing to her, Brother Ken.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, God bless you. Happy birthday to you.
All right, stand with me one more time. Page 506, I will sing of my Redeemer. We'll do all four verses of page 506.
I will sing of my Redeemer and his wondrous love to me. On the cruel cross he suffered, from the curse to set me free. Sing, oh sing of my Redeemer, oh with his blood he purchased me. On the cross he sealed my pardon, paid the debt and made me free. I will tell the wondrous story, how my lost estate to save. In his boundless love and mercy, he the ransom freely gave. Sing, oh sing of my Redeemer, oh with his blood he purchased me. On the cross he sealed my pardon, paid the debt and made me free. I will praise my dear Redeemer, his triumphant power I'll tell. How the victory he giveth over sin and death and hell. Sing, oh sing of my Redeemer, oh with his blood he purchased me. On the cross he sealed my pardon, paid the debt and made me free. I will sing of my Redeemer and his heavenly love to me. He from death to life hath brought me, Son of God with him to be. Sing, oh sing of my Redeemer, oh with his blood he purchased me. On the cross he sealed my pardon, paid the debt and made me free.
One more, page 510. Jesus is all the world to me. We'll do all four verses of page 510.
Jesus is all the world to me, my life, my joy, my all. He is my strength from day to day. Without him I would fall. When I am sad, I go. No other one can cheer me so. When I am sad, he makes me glad. He's my friend. Jesus is all the world to me, my friend in trial sore. I go to him for blessings and he gives him more. Sunshine and the rain, he sends a harvest, golden grain. Sunshine and rain, harvest of grain, he's my friend. Jesus is all the world to me, and true to him I'll be. Oh, how could I this friend deny, when he so true to me. Following him, I know he's right. He watches o'er me day and night. Following him by day and night, he's my friend. Jesus is all the world to me. I want no better friend. I trust him. Now I'll trust him when life's bleeding day shall end.
Let's take our morning tithes and offering. So if our ushers will come at this time, we'll pass the offering plates and trust that you'll give as God has prospered you in accordance to his word this morning. So you be faithful to worship the Lord in your giving. Certainly God has been faithful to take care of you and your needs. Let's ask the Lord to bless this offering, bless the remainder of our worship service today. Lee Bell, pray for us, buddy.
Mark and Joni have our special this morning.
Brother Bill and Sister Gloria Gaither wrote so many beautiful songs. This is one of those songs. It's called I Believe in a Hill Called Mount Calvary. I'm going to start in wrong key. Here we go.
I believe in a hill called Mount Calvary. that this life with its great mysteries surely someday will come to an end. But
thank you, Mark. Thank you, Ms. Joni. And you're right, Gaithers have written some excellent songs, and that's one of them. And we appreciate you singing that for us today. Take your Bibles and turn to Genesis chapter 29. Genesis chapter 29 this morning. And as you pray for us this week, pray that Brother Mark makes it through customs okay. And he has a hard time with custom agents. And Miss Joni can tell you about that probably more than I can. We were in Canada, I believe it was, a few years ago, and the customs agent asked him, said, "Are you here? Are you here in our country to make money or something like that, on business?" And Brother Mark looked at him and he said, "Man, I live in the United States of America in the state of Texas. You have nothing here that I want nor need." And I thought, "Oh, Brother Mark, while I agree, I don't want to get stuck in this country either." So. But anyway, so Genesis chapter 29. Now, Brother Mark's the best person in the world to travel with. And I mean that. I mean that. He's the best in the world to travel with. If there's something you don't want to eat, you give it to him. He eats everything. And doesn't matter what it is, he'll gobble it down, and he will truly enjoy every bite. And he's the best in the world to travel with. I mean that. I mean that. Genesis chapter 29. We are studying the life of Jacob. And certainly there are some great men of faith in the book of Genesis. God is known in the book of Genesis as the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. We've studied Abraham, we've studied Isaac, we've looked at pictures of Christ in the life of these two men. And last Sunday we started looking at Jacob. The Bible says in verse number 1 of Genesis chapter 29, "Then Jacob went on his journey." And as I was reading this in my Hebrew Old Testament, I was shocked a bit to see what the Hebrew text literally says. It literally says there, then Jacob lifted up his feet. In other words, he's got a new spring in his step. He has a new song in his heart. You recall, Jacob has just met the Lord. Jacob now has God in his life. You remember last Sunday morning the experience that he had, that dream where the ladder was sent down between heaven and earth. And Jacob, the young man who was running from home, in a sense, had a face-to-face personal encounter with God. And Jacob is now saved. But Jacob has a long way to go. It's true in the life of Jacob and in your life and mine as well that salvation is not the end of the matter. Salvation is the beginning of the matter. It's one thing to be saved, and it's a totally different thing to be sanctified and surrendered to the Lord. Now, salvation is an event, a very important event. There's that moment in time when you turn from your sin and receive Jesus as your personal Savior. That is an event. But sanctification is a process. And sanctification is the process of growing in righteousness. It's the process of becoming what God intended you to be when he saved you. And so salvation is an event. It happens in a moment. But sanctification will take the rest of your life. It takes an entire lifetime. And the process of sanctification involves itself in getting some things out of our life that ought not be there. When we're saved, we come into a new family, but we have some baggage from the old family. And God has to get that garbage out, the garbage of sin. God has to take out the leaven of the old life that oftentimes consumes us. And it's a process. God has to do a process. He has to do a work in each of our lives. And that will look different for you than it does for me and vice versa. Now, that's exactly what we're going to discover in the life of Jacob. You recall that Jacob is a schemer. He's a trickster. Sometimes when we come to the Lord, it takes the Lord a little while to work on us. And God's going to work on Jacob for about 20 years or so. Now, that doesn't matter to God. God is in no hurry. God is working, and he's developing, and he's using circumstances in your life, helping you to become everything that he wants you to become. Well, Jacob thinks that he's on the way to Haran. If you remember, his father, Isaac, thought it to be wise to send him away for a while because of the controversy between he and his brother. And so Jacob is sent to Haran. Haran's about 500 miles away. It's he's got some family there, and it's far enough where Esau won't follow him, but he won't be alone. He's got some kinfolk there in Haran. He's literally retracing the steps of his grandfather, Abraham, as Abraham left Haran. But actually, Jacob's not on the way to Haran at all. Oh, he is in the sense that that's where he's going. But Haran is not going to be Haran. Haran is going to be a school for Jacob. It's going to be the school of hard knocks. You ever attended that before? You ever been a student in the school of hard knocks? Jacob has an uncle named Laban, who's the brother of his mother, Rebecca. Laban is the dean. He's the professor of the school of hard knocks. When I think about Laban, I think about Charles Dickens' character, Scrooge. Let me read to you what Dickens said about Scrooge. He said about Scrooge that he was squeezing, wrenching, grasping, carping, clutching, covetous old sinner. Hard and sharp as flint, secret and self-contained as an oyster. When I think about that, I think about Laban. I think that could be said about Uncle Laban. God's going to use Uncle Laban to get this young man, Jacob, where he needs to be. It was at Bethel where Jacob met God, but it's in Haran that Jacob's going to meet people. He learned what God is like in Bethel, and he's going to learn what people are like in Haran. And I want to submit to you this morning and spend the remainder of my time proving it to be the case that both are extremely important. Here's a man who will out-Jacob Jacob. Laban is going to out-scheme the schemer himself. His name is Uncle Laban. For 20 years, he's going to become the dean of a school, the School of Hard Knocks, and Laban will be like a mirror for 20 years right in front of Jacob, letting Jacob see exactly what Jacob looks like. Sometimes God does that to us, doesn't he? Sometimes God lets us have experiences in life so that you can see what you really are portrayed in the life of someone else. Let's spend a little time this morning talking about Jacob, and I want to call your attention, number one, to Jacob serving. I find this in chapter 29 and 30. Now let me, because of the amount of text we're going to cover this morning, let me summarize the account for you, and I'll read a few verses in between. Jacob has come to the land of Haran. It's about 500 miles away from home. In verse number 2, he's going to find a well in the field. He's going to find some shepherds who have brought their flocks to be watered in that field. He looks up, and in verse number 6, he sees a beautiful young lady named Rachel coming with sheep. You remember that Jacob's a schemer. He's always figuring out ways. And so basically, you get to verse number 7, and notice what it says, "Lo, it is yet high day, neither is it time that the cattle should be gathered together. Water the sheep and go and feed them." And so Jacob sees Rachel, and Jacob does not want any competition. So in essence, he says, "Guys, don't you think it's time you move on somewhere else?" And Rachel comes along. Now, Rachel is the prettiest thing that he has ever laid eyes on. He looks at Rachel, and he is carried away with her. Verse 10 says, "It came to pass when Jacob saw Rachel." Verse 11 says, "And Jacob kissed Rachel." So things are moving quickly here. Jacob kissed Rachel, and the Bible said that he lifted up his voice and he wept. Somebody said if he had known what the future held, he would have cried out loud a lot longer. But it's a case of love at first sight. Jacob sends word to Laban that he's there, and in verse number 13, Uncle Laban comes into the picture, and when he hears of all that's taken place, he runs to meet Jacob. He embraces Jacob. Jacob gets the royal welcome in the home dear Uncle Laban. Verse 14, it says that Jacob abode with Laban for a month. And so for about a month, he's just kind of hanging around the house. He's going to the pantry whenever he wants to eat all of Uncle Laban's food. He's flirting with Rachel. He is falling head over heels. He has it made. Things are wonderful for about a month. But notice verse 15. Laban said unto Jacob, "Because thou art my brother," literally that would be better translated nephew, "should thou therefore serve me for naught, tell me what shall thy wages be." And I'm sure at this point Jacob is saying, "Well, wait a minute, no one said anything about me working." He didn't know he was supposed to come and work. He's having a good time. He's enjoying life. And so Uncle Laban's going to put Jacob to work. Now, there's a principle here. The principle is certainly shown in other places of the Bible. We call that the study of correlation, where Scripture correlates with one another. You cannot build a theological principle on one verse. It has to be proven over the course of Scripture as a whole. And in Matthew chapter 5, verse 31, the Bible says this, "Well done, thou good and faithful servant. You've been faithful over a few things. God says, I'll make you ruler over many things." It's this principle that's in plenty of places throughout the Scripture, that before God will ever make you a ruler, he will make you a servant. That you have to be willing to serve before you're ready to rule. And so he says to him, he says, "You're going to work for me, but I'll pay you. I'll pay you." Now you drop on down, there are two daughters in the picture. There's Rachel, and then there's Leah. Verse 17, the Bible says this about Leah, that Leah was tender-eyed. That means she's weak-eyed. That is, her eyes just don't have the sparkle that Rachel's have. On the other hand, the Bible says that Rachel's beautiful and that Rachel is well-favored. Rachel is obviously the one that Jacob is physically attracted to. Verse 18 confirms it because it says Jacob loved Rachel. He is in love with Rachel. He wants to marry Rachel. He's in love. He says in verse 18, "I will," to Laban, he says, "I'll serve thee 7 years for Rachel." thy younger daughter. And that's real love. It's real love. When a guy says, I'll work 7 years for you, his was a love that would stand the test of time. Will yours? Will your love stand the test of time? Listen to me, young person. That boyfriend says to you, I just can't wait. It's a pretty good sign that he's selfish and that he doesn't love you, that he loves himself, but he really doesn't love you a whole lot. Genuine love is willing to wait. Genuine love is willing to hold itself back. Let me just say this. You need to be real careful, young person, before entering into marriage. Adrian Rogers, my hero, said you can get married in a moment, but it may take you a lifetime to get over it. And so Jacob works for 7 years. You'll get that in a moment. He's willing to wait for Rachel. And the girls love this one. Notice in verse 20, and they seemed to him but a few days for the love he had for her. And that is so sweet and so romantic. And it's time for the wedding. And in those days, they had very interesting ceremonies. And notice in verse 21, Jacob says to Laban, give me my wife, for my days are fulfilled, that I may go in unto her. And Laban gathered together all the men of the place and made a feast. Now the schemer is about to be schemed. The deceiver is about to be deceived. Jacob, the trickster, is getting ready to be tricked himself. And you'll read in verse 22, verse 23, verse 24, verse 25, that Uncle Laban's going to pull a switch on Jacob. Jacob thinks he's marrying Rachel, and rather than Rachel, it's Leah. Now, I got to be real honest with you. I have read this and read this and read this. To be real honest with you, about 50 to 60 times just this week. And I have no clue how this is even possible. I don't know how in the world a guy could make a mistake like this. It's a big mistake. I do know that in those days that the marriage customs were such that the bride was heavily veiled, but I have never understood, and I don't know that I ever will, how a guy could absolutely marry the wrong woman. And yet, when you think about it, it happens all the time, doesn't it? I heard about a guy who said, my best friend ran off with my wife. Friend said, why, that dog, who is he? He said, I don't know, I hadn't met him yet. I heard about a girl who had her wedding ring on the wrong finger. It was kind of like this. And somebody said, why do you have your wedding ring on the wrong finger? She said, I married the wrong man. And Jacob wakes up the next morning, and he's married the wrong woman. He goes storming into Laban, and in verse 25, he says, what is this that thou hast done unto me? And it hits him like a ton of bricks. And basically what Laban is saying, and I'm going to paraphrase verse 26, is this. Jacob, you got to understand. You're not from our country. You don't know how we operate. And in our country, you never marry off the second born until you marry off the firstborn. And so Jacob had to work 7 more years in order to be married to his beloved Rachel. Now we find Jacob serving. He served 7 years in order to marry Rachel. And that leads me to my second point. Now we see him scheming. We're going to see that Jacob is not through with his scheming ways that we saw when he was still back home in Beersheba. Verse 31 and on into chapter number 30, you'll find the record of one writer titled his domestic woes. You find the family life of Jacob. It's the story of division. It's the story of a lot of turmoil, disturbance. You'll read about the 12 sons that are born to Jacob in this text, and they are the heads of the 12 tribes of the children of Israel. It is the historical beginning of the nation of Israel as we know it. But here's something else you'll find as you read through these verses. You'll find the secret history of the brokenhearted Leah. In verse number 31, it says, and when the Lord saw that Leah was hated, the word there means slighted, the Bible says that he opened her womb, but Rachel was barren. Now, Leah was never loved. Jacob never accepted Leah. He just kind of pushed her to the side, dealt with it as it were, it is what it is kind of attitude. And as you read through these accounts of the births of the different sons, you're going to find a lot of turmoil in this family. And for the sake of time, I don't have time to go into it, but you go through it and read chapter 30. Read chapter 31, and you'll see it easily. And let me just say this. Never, and I don't care what what other religions or denominations say. Never in the Bible is polygamy condoned. It's not. It's not. As a matter of fact, it's never commanded. The Bible simply records for us the fact that it did occur. But every time you find it occurring in Scripture, you find major problems attached to it every single time. And so here's a family in trouble. Jacob has been scheming, and he's going to scheme some more as we move along. Now, go to chapter number 30, and notice in verse number 1. It says, when Rachel saw that she bare Jacob no children, Rachel envied her sister and said to Jacob, give me children or else I die. Jacob's anger was kindled against Rachel, and he said, am I in God's stead? Who hath withheld from thee the fruit of the womb? Now, you can read the next few verses if you'd like, but I'll go ahead and fill you in. There's no evidence of prayer here, none. There's no evidence of Jacob seeking the will of God in this matter. Here's a man who has a lot of anger in his heart. Here's a man who is not who or what God wants him to be. Now, he's saved. He's born again at this point. This is the home of a believing man, but it's not a home that's been dedicated to God. So he blows up on Rachel. Now, in spite of that, God does give children later on to Rachel. That's recorded for us in these verses. In verse 22, the Bible says that God remembered Rachel and God hearkened unto her and God opened her womb. But we see Jacob scheming. We see as he moves through this whole domestic turmoil, he's going to do so with a lot of problems. And let me just say this to our families. When we get away from the Lord, and when the Lord and serving Him is not priority, and when we don't put Jesus first in our families, and bring our boys and our girls up in the things of God, you mark it down. You're headed for turmoil. You're headed for heartache. You are headed for confusion. Your children are headed for problems and confusion. You've got to keep in mind, he's been gone for about 20 years at this point. And something is tugging at his heart. And in verse 25 of chapter 30, it says this, it came to pass when Rachel had borne Joseph, that Jacob said to Laban, send me away that I may go into my own place and to my country. Now notice what Jacob does here. You're going to see that he schemes to get the cattle. It's interesting. In verse 31, Laban says, what shall I give thee? And basically, Jacob says, not much of anything, not a whole lot. I've had enough of Uncle Laban after 20 years. But he does say this, give me the speckled and the spotted cattle, and the brown cattle among the sheep, and the spotted and speckled among the goats, and of such shall be my hire. And so he's kind of picked out the animals that he wants. Laban agrees. Watch this, and this is interesting. Verse 35, and he removed that day the he-goats that were ring-streaked and spotted, and all the she-goats that were speckled and spotted, and every one that had some white in it, and all the brown among the sheep, and gave them into the hand of his sons. That's what Laban did. Verse 36, and he set 3 days' journey between himself and Jacob fed the rest of Laban's flocks. And Jacob took him rods of green poplar, and of hazel, and chestnut tree, and peeled white streaks in them and made the white appear which was in the rods. And he set the rods which he had peeled before the flocks and the gutters and the watering troughs when the flocks came to drink that they should conceive when they came to drink. And the flocks conceived before the rods and brought forth cattle ring-straked, speckled, and spotted. John Phillips said that Jacob stumbled upon what he believes to be Mendel's law. Learn something here about selective breeding. Now, God doesn't approve of this kind of scheming. Sometimes, in spite of our scheming, God is working in the circumstances of our lives. It's kind of like a beginning chess player and a master chess player. The master chess player, he's in charge of the board at all times, whether the beginner knows it or not. And whatever move the beginner makes, the master's on top of it. You make a move, and the master has, in reality, probably made two or three at that point. Well, God is the master chess player, and God wants you to win. Move number one is you receive Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior. Jacob's done that. Then God begins to arrange circumstances in your life. And as you move through life, you're going to make mistakes. You're going to have problems. You're going to disobey the Lord. From time to time, you may get out of His will. But God is maneuvering, and He's still arranging circumstances in your life that ultimately will bring you to a point where you see your need in him and get back to where you need to be. Jacob's scheming. It leads me to my third point, and that is Jacob's stealing. Notice in chapter 31, verse number 1, it says, and he heard the words of Laban's sons. Now, this is Jacob. Jacob's hearing Laban's sons. And here's what they said. Jacob hath taken away all that was our father's, and of that which was our father's hath he gotten all this glory. In verse 2, he looked at his uncle Laban, and he could tell by the look on Uncle Laban's face, Uncle Laban's upset with me. He's not happy with me. You can tell when someone's not happy with you, can't you? Just by the look on their face. When someone's upset with you, you can see their countenance. And that's true right here. He can look at Laban, and the phrase that he uses is this, that he looks at the countenance of Laban, and it was not toward him as before. Wasn't kind, wasn't open, it wasn't welcoming. Verse 3, and the Lord said to Jacob, return into the land of thy fathers and to thy kindred. And here's a promise from God to Jacob, I will be with thee. Circumstances have changed. Things are not the way they were. He sees that things are rather unsettled and hostile. And in addition to that, God is beginning to pull at his heart. And the Lord begins to speak to him and says, look, it's time for you to go back home. It's time for you to get back to the land of your father. Sometimes God begins to move on our hearts. And sometimes God begins to call us to himself. Well, he's calling Jacob. And in verse 4, Jacob's going to have a family conference. The Bible says, and Jacob sent and called Rachel and Leah to the field. They get out there with some privacy where nobody will hear them. And it's a secret meeting. And he says in verse 5, I see your father's countenance, that it is not toward me as before, but the God of my father hath been with me. And you know that with all my power I've served your father. And your father hath deceived me and changed my wages 10 times. Jacob still doesn't get it. Jacob has already deceived his own dad, Isaac, who was almost blind. And he still doesn't see himself. The mirror of Laban is right in front of him, and he's missing it. He's missing it. It's very easy to see the faults in other people, isn't it? It's a lot easier to see the faults in someone else than it is to see the faults of our own. Oh, I can tell you the mistakes in the lives of a lot of people a lot easier than I can tell you Wesley's mistakes. And if we're honest, most of us are pretty quick to blame somebody else instead of being pretty quick to take the blame that belongs to us. And so Jacob calls a family conference. Maybe some of you dads need to have a family conference. You need to get your family together and have a little powwow, spiritual powwow. You need to have a little talk about the things of God. And maybe it's been a while since you've, with your family, read God's Word and had a devotion and prayed with your family. The more I read the Bible, the more I am struck with the fact that God places the primary responsibility of the family on the father, on you, men. It's the father who is spiritually responsible. And there are a lot of spiritually weak, need dads today who let the wife and the mother be the spiritual leader. If that's you, shame on you. Fix that, dad. You, sir, are the spiritual leader of your home. And some dads need to get the family together and say, listen, I want you to know I'm sorry. I haven't been the spiritual leader that I need to be. I haven't been the man God wants me to be. I haven't been the father God wants me to be. But we're getting back to Bethel. We're getting back to serving God, to the things of God. And the Bible says in verse 14, after Jacob talks about the matter, it says, Rachel and Leah answered and said to him, is there yet any portion or inheritance for us in our father's house? Verse 16, for all the riches which God hath taken from our father, that is ours and our children's. Now then, whatsoever God hath said to thee, do. Then Jacob rose up and set his sons and his wives upon camels, and he carried away all his cattle and all his goods which he had gotten, cattle of his getting which he had gotten in Paddan Aram, for to go to Isaac his father in the land of Canaan. And Laban went to shear his sheep, and Rachel had stolen the images that were her father's. Images, there are gods, little g, household gods, pagan gods. They take off while Laban is away in the field tending to a business matter, and Jacob gets his wives and their children together, and they take off. They're stealing away. And here's what happened. In verse 24, God came to Laban in a dream by night, and he said to him, take heed that thou speak not to Jacob, either good or bad. God is saying, don't mess with him. Don't touch him. Don't touch him. In verse 25, he overtakes Jacob. He says to him in verse 26, and Laban said to Jacob, what hast thou done? Hast thou stolen away unawares to me and carried away my daughters as captives taken with the sword? So that's what he says the problem is. That's what he says has got him all upset. But notice what really had him upset. Verse 30. Now, though thou would needs be gone, because thou sore long after thy father's house, that is, because you're so ready and you're so anxious just to leave here and get back to your father's house, notice this, yet wherefore hast thou stolen my gods? That's what he's upset about. That's what's got him angry. Oh, I'm sure it bothers him that his daughters are leaving, his grandchildren are leaving. But he's mad about his gods. You know what those gods were? They were little figurines that they put around the house. They represented pagan gods. And here's what happened. Rachel had stolen them, and she's sitting on top of them. Think about that figuratively. Here are the gods that old Laban's worshiping. They've been stolen, and they are being used like furniture. Some gods, huh? Let me ask you about your gods. Can your gods get rust on them? Some gods, if so. Can your gods lose in the playoffs? Some god. Can your gods be stolen? Can your gods be lost? That's what Laban's upset about. He couldn't find them because Rachel is sitting on top of them. He comes out kind of, man, he's like he's looking for weapons of mass destruction. He just can't locate them. And so he comes out empty-handed. He can't come up with these household gods. And in verse number 36, Jacob loses it. The Bible says he's wroth. And that's one of the strongest words in all of the Bible for anger. It means that he is burning on the inside with anger. That is, the fuse has been lit, and it's coming to its end. 20 years of frustration and problems are boiling up on the inside, and it comes out. And he says to Laban in verse 36, what is my trespass? What is my sin that thou hast so hotly pursued after me? Whereas thou hast searched all my stuff, what hast thou found of all thy household stuff? He blows up. He's angry. He's wroth. It's coming out. And he says in verse 41, thus have I been 20 years in thy house. I served thee 14 years for thy two daughters and 6 years for thy cattle. And thou hast changed my wages 10 times. It's the second time he said that. He's just letting it all hang out. You get in verse 43 and verse 44, and Laban basically says, let's make a covenant. Now therefore come thou, let us make thee a covenant, verse 44, I and thou, and let it be for a witness between me and thee. They set up an altar, they take stones, they build an altar. Laban said, this altar shall be a witness between you and me. That's not a witness of peace. But basically he's saying, let's build this altar, and the Lord's got his eyes on you, and you just know I've got my eyes on you too. And that's a sad way that this story comes to a conclusion. But God has been in the process for 20 years, chipping away little by little, little by little, little by little, sanctifying Jacob. And God is using these 20 years, and God is working in his saint's life. I was eating lunch a couple of years ago in Humble City Cafe by myself, and I was talking to the waiter. And he was sharing with me some difficulties that he had experienced in life recently. He's unloading on me. It was kind of one of those situations. You remember a few months ago when Scott Matthews and his family were here, and Scott said in his message, listen, he learned real quickly, don't ask some people, how are you doing, if you don't want to know how they're doing. It was one of those situations. I said, how are you doing, to this waiter, and he unloaded on me. Told me everything going on in his life, difficulty-wise, problem-wise. And he asked me this question. He knew I was a pastor, and he said this. He said, preacher, are there some people who it just seems like everything goes wrong for them, that nothing will ever go right. And here's what I said to him, and here's what I would say to you. No, there are no people that everything just goes wrong. I told him this, it's really not so important what happens to you as it is how you respond to what happens to you. Bad things happen to everybody. Difficult situations come in the lives of everybody. Problems are going to come in your life and in mine. Nobody is exempt from that. Circumstances are going to be difficult in the life of every single person. But it's not so important what happens to you as how you respond to what happens to you. I read the story of a young man who had some small children, and his wife tragically died. And so now he is a single dad, single father with young children. He goes home after the funeral burying his wife, and it was so dark in his house. He was so discouraged and so depressed. And in prayer, he talked to the Lord, and I love what he said. He said, Lord, everything seems to be all wrong. But Lord, I'm going to trust that you will make everything all right. God gives us a promise in Romans chapter 8, verse 28. Many of you would say, this is my life verse. And we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to those who are called according to his purpose. When you read the life of Jacob and these passages that we have quickly moved through this morning, you can't say that everything that happened to Jacob was good, because it wasn't. There was a lot of bad things that took place in the life of Jacob. You can't say that all the problems that came to Jacob were good things. But Romans 8:28 sure is going to come true, as you'll see in the next coming Sundays. I heard a story about a pastor. He was preaching in a small town, country town, and a couple invited him over for supper. It was a farming couple. And the man gathered everyone around his table to eat supper. The guest preacher was there, his wife and others. And the man said, let's bless the food before we eat. And here's what he said, something like this. He said, Lord, you know that I cannot stand flour. I hate it. And he said, Lord, you know that I cannot stand buttermilk. I hate it. And Lord, you know that I cannot stand oil by itself. I hate it. He said, but Lord, when you put those three together, you know that I love good homemade biscuits. And he said, Lord, help me to realize that when things come into my life, that they're working together to create something good. Pharmacy is much similar to that. God's a master pharmacist. The pharmacist will take the different ingredients and begin to pound and crush them and compound them and put them together. And any one of those individual ingredients in and of themselves could be detrimental to your health, to your life. But the pharmacist knows what he's doing, and he can take individual detrimental compounds and put them together with skillful hands and create a cure for a disease. And in life, that's a lot like what God does. God is the master pharmacist. He takes everything that comes into your life, if you're his child, and he will work that together somehow, some way, for good. And you won't understand it in the process. You'll go through a situation and you'll say, Lord, what in the world are you doing? But God has a purpose. And I don't know what you're going through this morning, but I do know that God is working in your life. I do know that. I do know that God has brought you to this place, to this time, for this moment, for some reason. And how you respond to what's going on in your life is going to determine how much good God can bring. And this will be illustrated vividly in 2 weeks. Jacob is on the verge of the experience that will make a prince out of him. I wonder if someone here this morning is on the verge of an experience that will turn your life around and create a brand new person that can be used for the remainder of your life for the glory of God. With our heads bowed and our eyes closed, Brother Ken, if you and our musicians will come. Maybe you're lost this morning. you've been going through situations and trials and circumstances that were painful, that were difficult, that hurt, that didn't make a ton of sense. And maybe the master pharmacist was using those situations to bring you to this place, this time, 12:03 p.m., October 20th, 2024, so that the God of heaven could speak to your heart, convict you of your sin, and save your soul. If so, don't pass this opportunity. Don't leave this place without coming to Jesus. Give your heart to him today. Trust in the gospel and be saved. Come forward in a moment and let me take God's word and show you how you can be born again. And you'll see how these situations were used by God to bring you to a place of salvation. But maybe you're like Jacob and you're saved. You've been saved. But you're in this sanctifying process. You're still maturing. You're growing. You're not all that God would have you to be. Maybe some situations in life haven't been pretty. They've been hard. They've been difficult. They've been painful. Maybe, like Jacob, you need to realize that God was using them like the master potter as he chips away on the clay, molding it to what he wants it to be. Maybe God is using these situations in your life to make you a little more like Jesus, to make you a little more to the person that he wants you to be. Father, I bow in your presence, and I pray that you would work in this invitation as only you can. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.